Morning.
Good morning, some guys. Yeah. Okay, this is nice. Well, greetings to you all. Let's please stand where we are. Unless you don't have a few or something, let's just submit our hearts and our minds to the Lord. Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this privilege, this place, this opportunity. Lord, we are so blessed. Because if we have repented of our sins and received Christ, we belong to you. And Lord, we are here to worship you, to lift you up, to serve you. We know you are our eternal God, and that is so important to us. And Lord, may we sing this morning, lifting up these praises to you as though it is an expression of just how important you are to us. We just thank you again. May you be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, King of Kings.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is glad to see all of you who skated in here and made it through the ice. And we are glad to be in the house of the Lord, to be able to worship together. And I've got good news for you. Even though that groundhog was wrong, we're going to have some warmer temperatures this week. So, yeah, I think we're all done with winter, aren't we? Whether it's done with us or not is another matter. But we are glad to have you with us. If you are visiting with us for the first time, or maybe the first time in a long time, in front of you in the pew, there's a welcome card. If you would fill that out and drop that in the offering plate as it comes by, we would appreciate a record of your visit. And this is our prayer time, so if you would, please take your prayer sheet out of your bulletin. And we're going to remind you of a few of those prayer requests and give you an update on that. And the first one is Colleen Collins. She is at home, but she is still struggling a little bit. And so we want to remember to keep her in prayer as things are not going as well as they had hoped. And so just keep her in your prayers if you would. And then we have a praise and a prayer request and a request for our church. And that is this, that Charlotte Spencer is out of the hospital and she is now in Kent Nursing and Rehab. And so that is exciting. And so she is beginning her rehab process there. She is in room 305. And so if you would like to visit her, they are allowing visitors. They'll let anyone in because they let me in yesterday. she would love a visit, or if you'd like to send a card, I can get you that address or contact the office and do that. I know that would be an encouragement to her. She has a long recovery process coming. And so with that, one of the things that has happened is that she is in need of dialysis now three times a week. And so she needs to be taken to dialysis at DaVita, right across from Walmart there, three times a week, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And so this is we are asking you as the church to become the hands of Christ in helping one another. And so we need some people that can help to do that. And she goes in, she needs to be picked up at 6 in the morning and dropped off, and then picked up about between 9 and 9:30 in the morning. And she needs that three times a week. Yes?
Just to let you know, because I know with my husband, Council on Aging will also do that.
They will not in her case, because she is at Kenton Nursing and Rehab.
Oh.
And so it is on us as the church to do that. And so we have set up rides for this Monday. And so we are asking the church members if you would be willing to do that, and even if it is one or the other, if it's pick her up or drop her off one day, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, she needs to be picked up at 6 at Kent Nursing Rehab and taken over and dropped off. And then she needs to be picked up at 9, between 9 and 9:30 at DaVita and taken back to Kent Nursing Rehab. Not a long trip, but it's there. And so as the church, we're asking you, would you be willing to help out with that? And this is one of those ways in which we prove John 13:35 true. And that is this. Jesus said to his disciples, "By this they will know that you are my disciples, by your love one for another." And this is one way that we can just really show Charlotte and the world our love in Christ. Yes? She is able to get into a car. She is not able to get into an SUV. Yeah. Yeah, she can't get up, she can get down. So, yes. Contact myself, Pastor Craig, or the church office. Probably the church office is best because Betty keeps things straight around here. But we're asking for your help in doing that, and that would be great if you could help us out with that. Yes? No, they will have wheelchairs at both places. So it's really just getting her in and out of the car. So. Okay, so that's that is a big request right there. And but Again, this is where we as the church love and take care of one another. And if someone has a need, we're going to take care of it one way or the other, right? And so, yes?
They will help lower in the car too, right?
Yes, yeah. They have staff there that will help to load and to help to get her in the car and get her out of the car at both places. So it's not like you're having to do it all, but it's really more of being there to be the Lyft driver. I don't know, unpaid Uber, something like that. But yeah, we'll be the Uber driver. So anyway. But that's what we're looking to do, and if there's more questions, we can answer that as we go along. But if you'd be willing to do that, please let us know. We want to remind you also of other prayer requests that we have. Don't forget our people that are homebound that cannot get here, and our senior of the week is Joanne Berry, and pray for her. She has had a long-term painful back. She has her spine has cracks in it, and there's really nothing more they can do for her. And so be in prayer for her. She is in pain every day. And she could not come to sit through a church service because she couldn't sit for that long. And so be in prayer for her and for Bill as they are just in difficult times. And also remember our missionaries, Wayne and Patsy Gibson. They are back in Columbia, and they are doing their final go-round. They are preparing the Piacopoco people for their departure in about a year. And so pray for them with that, that the Lord would help them to organize things and the Piacopoco people, that they would be ready to take over the ministry. And pray also as they do that, we have more teams getting set up to take the Word of God up to Venezuela, and so upriver to there, and so be in prayer for that as well. So there are more prayer requests on there. Keep that with you during the week so that you can pray for those. If our men would come forward, we're going to have our morning's offering. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time in which we can come and worship you. We thank you that we can worship you because of what we have in Jesus Christ, and the forgiveness and the redemption that we have, that we have been saved. You have done what we could not do for ourselves, and we thank you for that, God. We thank you for the love of Christ and how we enjoy that together. And Lord, we want to pray right now for Colleen Collins, that as her recovery is longer and harder than expected, we pray that you will heal her body, and that, Lord, as she is healing, that you would strengthen her spirit, Lord. That, Lord, as she spends time in your word and praying, that, Lord, you would give her more strength, that truly your strength would be demonstrated in her weakness, and that she could glorify you in the midst of this. And Lord, we would ask the same thing for Charlotte as she recovers. And Lord, she has a long recovery process. And now with dialysis 3 times a week, Lord, we pray that you'd lift her spirit up, that you would bear her on your wings, that you would carry her along, and that you would encourage her heart, Lord. Lord, we pray for Joanne Berry. She's just in a lot of pain right now. That, Lord, you would be her comfort and strength, and that you would help her and Bill as they are housebound now, Lord, and help them, Lord, that they may draw closer to you and have comfort in the middle of a situation which is very difficult. And Lord, we know that you are the God of all comfort, and so we pray that you would. Lord, we pray for the Gibsons as they are reacclimating to Columbia, and Lord, as they're really preparing for their last push of this race. Lord, help them to finish well. Lord, I pray that you would smooth out the roads, that things would be prepared for the Piacopocos, and you would work in their hearts, that the leaders would be established and firm, and that they would carry out the ministry faithfully. Lord, we pray for the teams that are preparing to teach again in Venezuela and take the word there. that you would prepare the way in the hearts of people, that you would keep them safe, that you would keep them healthy, Lord, and that your word would go out, and that the Piapoco people would all know who Jesus Christ is, and that many would be saved as a result. Lord, as we give our tithes and our offerings, Lord, we give them with a joyful heart, thankful and grateful for you, for all that you have done for us today, both spiritually and physically. We are so blessed, and we thank you for that. And we ask that the rest of our service will be glorifying to you and uplifting to you as we worship you with all our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
We are. I'll have the young people make their way back to the back at this time. As they head back. Everybody have a good time this week learning how to ice skate again?
All of it!
You did, didn't you? Yes.
Yes. All of
it. It was awesome, wasn't it? Yes, it was. You know, I went out to my car the last couple days. I felt like I was about 120 years old shuffling to get to my car. Took a spill at one point, and I don't know how. The angels of God must have caught me because I thought, oh my goodness. I was glad to see the parking lot was as clean as it was because I know some of you have put salt out and it probably did no good because it just was so thick. And I had talked to someone today and they said they looked up from their fireplace and their truck was in the middle of the street and just slid right on down. So it has been a icy one. Also, Irene, she says she still has ice skates and skis for her driveway. So she skied all the way down to get her ride on the way in today. It was great. Yes, it has been quite the icy situation. What you see on my face is only because of the drama that's up and coming. I have to work a long time to get a beard, let me tell you. And you know, I thought it was ice that was on there. But it's awful white. Last time I did this, it was not this white. So I'm going to blame all of you for that. I don't know. Don't know.
I have an answer for that.
Oh, you have an answer? I'll come see you and you'll darken that all up. Well, fantastic. Next week, you'll see me with it. We're really dark. And she's going to leave this white stripe right down the middle. All the way back. Thanks, Pam. I'm not seeing you.
Anything for you.
Well, hey, this morning in preparation for this message, I was reminded of an illustration I gave before. Some of you will have heard this, but many may not even remember. But it's told about a captain of a ship, and they were going along, and the fog had rolled in. And as the fog rolled in, he peered deep into the night and trying to look through the fog, and he saw a light directly in front of them. And he was certain he knew exactly where he was. And so he told the signal man to send a message to that approaching vessel. And he said, "Alter your course 10 degrees. The reply came back, "Alter your course 10 degrees to the north." The captain became very furious and sent another message. "Alter your course 10 degrees to the south. I'm a captain." Soon, another reply came back. "Alter your course 10 degrees north. I am a seaman, third class Jones." The captain sent a final message. "Alter your course 10 degrees south. I am a battleship." The reply came back, "Alter your course 10 degrees north. I am a lighthouse." You know, in every generation, there is a fog that comes in to and around this world. And it distorts what we see. And as we get into the fog, it's Christ's word that stands as that immovable lighthouse that strikes its light through the fog and pierces that confusion for those who will respond to it. Those who refuse to respond to the word of God, unknowing to them, they are moving to where it's an immovable rock-filled shore that will destroy them if they do not alter their course. Isaiah 5 and verse 20, I have this listed and I want to put it up on the board. So with that, Isaiah 5 and verse 20 says these words, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. I think those verses are very apropos for our message and our sermon series of maintaining God's light in today's world, in today's culture. Because the culture of man has become this great fog that has just come and consumed. And man has said, has redefined what is evil as good, and what is good as evil. And we as a church and as Christians who follow Jesus Christ, we have the light of his word, and we must not alter the course to anything else other than to God's light. May we not be overcome by this culture. And so, as we've been talking about all these different things that you can do, I talked to someone this past week, and they were really down and out about the culture and everything that's going on. And I shared with them, I said, you know, I'm done. I'm done with complaining about the culture. Because the culture is not going to change unless Jesus Christ changes the individuals within the culture. Until they have a new light by which they can run their life, by which they can live their life. And so with it, I'm saying, you know what? What a great opportunity we have. So if you find yourself just grumbling and complaining, I encourage you to start looking at it as an opportunity to be a light, a lighthouse in this dark and confused world. That we can actually do those things and share the message of Jesus Christ. In John chapters 13, 14, 15, and 16. That's where we're at right now. And we're saying, okay, this is what Jesus said to the disciples. This is what he taught them as he said, I'm going to now go send you out. I'm leaving, but I'm going to send you out, and you're going to continue the mission. You are not going to be overcome by the darkness, but may we overcome the darkness with his light. And so as Christians, we have an opportunity in front of us. And I am finding more and more opportunities to bring hope to people who are totally confused. And may we learn to be able to take God's word and bring that to the surface, bring it right to them, so that they might consider another way to approach this culture, this life, and the confusion that they are looking at. Let's go ahead and stand with me, and let's read from John chapter 14. Let's stand together and read God's word. We're going to start in verse 7, where we left off last week. And we're just going to read down to verse number 14. Jesus says to his disciples, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me. Or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to the Father, to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Let's pray. Our gracious God and Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have once again to open up your word and, Lord, seek your light as to how we are to navigate in the cultural fog that is wanting to envelop us. Lord, that we would not be overcome by it, but, Lord, we would look to your light and be directed by it. Lord, we are so thankful that we do not have to go without a word, without your direction, without understanding, for you give us your wisdom, your thoughts, your way. And Father, may we be committed to following you even when we cannot see you. We pray this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. the night of Jesus' arrest, which is that's where we're at in John, he is going to be arrested just in a few hours. And this conversation that Jesus has with his disciples is a very weighty conversation. It's a conversation that has great importance to us as we talk about moving forward in our culture. It is a question that Philip asks, not necessarily really more of a request, I guess, is what he asked of Christ. And it comes down to, really, who is Jesus? Who really is he? Is he just a prophet? Is he a man? Or is he really the Savior? Can he really be trusted whether you can see him or not see him? So often we walk by sight more than we walk by faith, don't we? It's what I see. It's what I presume. It's what I think is going to happen. And we don't walk by faith like we should. We are often saying, you know, well, it looks like this, so therefore I'm going to do that. And we do it in our own understanding, in our own ways, and we oftentimes will find ourselves in a wrong position. But yet here it comes about walking by faith and not by sight, that we have to have a firm belief and understanding of who Jesus Christ is. Is he truly our Lord and our Savior? Or is he just someone who pacifies us? Is he somebody who is there that we just pray a prayer and expect him to come and comfort us and give us what we want? We have to be assured of who Jesus is if we are going to navigate successfully through this culture. And this Jesus, he was able to be trusted. Because think about some of the things that he did while he was on this earth to kind of prove himself. He did many things. Remember the disciples, they were sinking in a ship, and where did Jesus come about? He walked on the water and he calmed the winds and the waves. What an amazing God. He fed 5,000 in front of them. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He fed over 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Tyree Latham just went fishing, and he would say, what? There's no way I can feed 5,000 people with even the fish I got. Give them to Jesus. You can feed more than 5,000. Would he be trustworthy if he was going to be leaving? They were troubled. In verse number 1, let not your heart be troubled. Why was it troubled? Because they had heard he was leaving. He told them ahead of time, I'm going to be gone. And so with it, they were ready to kind of say, okay, what is going to happen with us? Did I waste the last 3.5 years? I hear Christians who think, have I really wasted my time in this Christianity? Because my life is falling apart. I knew a man, he was married to his wife, obviously, and they had a marriage that was based all in the world. Neither one were saved. He got saved, and his wife didn't like it at all. Fought him tooth and nail, and to this day, as far as I know, she has never accepted Christ, and she wants him consistently not go to church, not to be godly, because she wants to go to the bars. You know, following Jesus is not an easy thing to do. It isn't. And those who think that you follow Christ because it's a crutch, no, it's a harder road than to not follow him. Because he's going to ask you to do things that you may not want to do. Talk to Moses. Think about Abraham. Go and sacrifice your son. How many of you would volunteer for that outing? You see, God doesn't save us to make it so simple and so easy. What God is wanting to do is to build our faith in him, not in our sight. To trust him when we can't see the end result. To trust him when I don't know what the outcome of my surgery is going to be. To trust him no matter what with my life, even if it means that I will not live any longer in this world. Trust in God is something that is must be built within us through Christ himself. So the question for you is, where is your belief? Is it simply belief? For even the demons believe and tremble, but yet they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Belief is one thing, and trust is another. As we consider this, I want to start off with this idea that trust in Christ, or walking by faith, you must put it in the right person. There are certain people you wouldn't trust, isn't there? But there are other people that you have more trust in. Why? Because they have proven themselves to be trustworthy. And Jesus Christ begins this whole conversation with Philip based upon his person. And so as we consider this, we need to walk of faith is trusting in Christ. He announces right away to Thomas and the other disciples that he is going to leave, and it does leave them in the lurch. The request that Philip asked, listen to what he asked Jesus to do. After Jesus says, he says, verse 7, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also, and from now on you know him and have seen him. Philip asked a very good question, or asked a request that I think I would have asked. He says, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Show me. Show me the Father. Reveal him to us, and then we will believe. They were still walking not by faith, but they were walking by what? Sight. They were so, Christ, Jesus, he has to be physically present with me. And I would be right there with the disciples. I would be. Seeing Jesus every day, you wake up and you just assume he's going to be there, and you're almost anticipating, what's the next miracle going to be? Wonder what he's going to do next. Wonder what he's going to teach next. It was exciting day after day after day. They saw Jesus in so many different situations, and then to think that he was going to be gone. I think we often fail to put ourselves into these disciples' sandals to really understand what it must have been like for them. We could shoot some arrows at them, but yet if we were in their sandals, we would probably be asking similar questions. And so Jesus begins to sit down and explain to them what he meant and what needed to happen in their life. First of all, faith is based on his words. Look there at verse number 10. In verse number 10, do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Jesus did not come down into the earth and just spout off just his ideas. He spoke exactly what God the Father would speak. He was the God of the Old Testament, speaking as the God of the New Testament, the same words, doing things that the God of the Old Testament does. They were one and the same. And so he tells Philip, I want you to believe my words. What words did he teach them? You see, when we are in this world and when we are confused by the culture or by things that we are seeing, one of the things that we need to do is recall God's words. You're going through a difficult time and you're really confused. You're really concerned about everything. Recall God's words. Go back to the Word of God. Read in the book of Psalms. Remind yourself of what God has done, what he said he would do. Remind yourself, preach to you the words of God rather than the words of this world. That's a big difference, isn't it? Don't recite Dr. Phil. Don't. Don't recite whoever it is. Recite God's words into your life. What did he say? What did he promise? The words of God are important because they're based on a trustworthy source. Has God failed to fulfill his promises? No. What God says, he will do. God's words, they're the same yesterday, today, and forever. When people want you to change the definitions of things, stick to the definition of God. You won't go wrong. Because his definitions will last forever. His words will last forever. For the word of God will endure forever. Not one jot nor tittle will fail or fall away. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of God, what? Never falls away. Folks, we hold in our hands the words of God that are never changing. Isn't it nice to have something that doesn't change in a world that is constantly changing? This past week, a lot of changes happened in the world, hasn't it? And man is freaked out about what's going to happen as a result. God is not going to be moved. The people in Ukraine, the people in Russia, may we as believers pray for them. That God's will be done. That God will move amongst the people and people will come to know Christ as their Savior. That should be our prayer. You know, as we think about what's happening in the world, this is a little off script, but hey, what's happening in our world right now, I think our prayers get a little off base. We pray that Russia would be stopped and all these things. What if that's not God's will? Are we really praying the right thing? Kind of getting ahead of my notes here, actually. We'll get back to that. But faith is based on Jesus' words. What did Jesus say? Jesus told the disciples in John 10, verse 30, he said, I and my Father are what? One. So as he's talking to Philip, he's saying, look, I am in the Father is in me. Remember my words? Remember what I taught you? Remember what I said? I and my Father are one. What did you think I meant? The Pharisees knew what he meant. In John 10, 33, it's very interesting. For a good work, he asked them, why are you going to stone me? Because the Pharisees and those, they picked up stones to kill him. He was like, why are you stoning me? Is it because I did a good work? They said, for a good work we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God. They got it, didn't they? When he said, I and my Father are one, he was claiming to be who? God. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus was very clear about who he was. And being God means that even though he was going to leave them, did that mean that he was not going to be involved in their life? No. Not at all. And he was reminding Philip of what he said. John 6:38, for I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Jesus says, look, I didn't come down here to do whatever I wanted to do. I am doing exactly what God the Father wants me to do, and I want to do. We're doing this together. We do it as one is what we do. So as you see me working, who else are you seeing at work? The Father. So Philip, as you have seen me, you have seen the Father. I have taught you this. My words have been true. And I want you to see me based upon my trustworthiness. Recall the words of God. The second thing here, verse 11. He brings him to this. He says, believe me that I'm in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the what? The works themselves. In other words, if you can't trust my words, then look at my works that I have done. Does that not reveal who I am? Well, it would be kind of hard to miss that one. And so I want to challenge us in this regard. As we recall God's words, if you are floundering in this world, recall the works of God that he has done in your life. You're saying, oh my goodness, I just don't know that I can stick with God right now. I just don't know what he's doing. Look back. Have you seen God work in the past in your life? Have you seen him deliver you from time to time in your life? Have there been times that you cried out to him, and in the midst of that, you had no idea that you were going to even survive? And yet later you say, to God be the glory. Don't forget what God has done. Don't forget the wonderful salvation that he has brought to you. Don't forget those times that he bailed you out and displayed his grace and mercy in your life. The times that you thought, my goodness, I have no idea what I'm going to do next. But God, in his wonderful grace and mercy, came to your rescue. Recall those moments when you are overwhelmed in the present. What were his workings? Let me share this working of Jesus that ties in his words and his work. Jesus said, love your enemies. Do good to those who despitefully use you. Pray for those. Bless them. Don't curse them. Did Jesus actually do that? You see, that's a work of Christ. He said it by his words, but then he fulfilled it time and time again. But also, we can look at his works, and for Philip, I am sure his mind went to the many miracles. Because who has the power over the spiritual world to cast out demons like Jesus? God. Who has the power over nature to make the winds and the waves to stop? God. Who has the power over the laws of nature to walk on water? I don't know, has anybody tried to walk on water? I mean, deeper than in your bathtub when it first gets in there. Okay? God does. Jesus Christ himself would point back to who has the power over death to raise the dead. Would that not explain to you that this is not just a man, but maybe I can trust him? When he says, I'm leaving, but don't worry about it. I've got something else for you. If his words are not enough, recall what he has done. God had taken care of the Hebrew children over and over again, didn't he? His works were ever before them. If the disciples at this moment would have decided to not believe in Jesus, could you imagine? Philip, I'm done. I hear your words, I hear your works, but I'm done. I'm out of here. They'd have been like Judas Iscariot, wouldn't they? They would have left and departed and been gone. And yet they were being challenged by Christ to walk by faith and not by what? What you're seeing and what your sight is telling you is not what is going to happen. The captain on the ship, what you're seeing is not what it really is. What you see, yes, is a light, but your interpretation of the whole situation is wrong. And if you don't change and alter, beware. Jesus knew the disciples were scared and distressed. He knew they were considering a job change. He knew their hearts were really at a point of, what are we going to do next? In verse number 12, it says these words, most assuredly. Some of your Bibles say, verily, verily. Some of them may say, truly, truly. Okay? There are two Greek words, and they're repeated. You know why they're repeated? Because he really wants to make a point. Truly, truly, verily, verily, most assuredly, I want to tell you this. And what is it he wants to tell us? So this is where I want us to get to. I really want us to focus in on what was going to happen. Because we think in our situation, God may be done with me. It is over. It is done. I'm just going to pack it in. And Jesus tells the disciples, your last 3.5 years have not been wasted. Your walking with me has not been wasted. Christian, your walking with me is not wasted. Your time with me is not something that is just supposed to be temporary and that's done. And he says these words to them. Looking here at verse 12, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do because I go to my Father. Philip, disciples, I'm going, but you're going to continue on. You're going to do my works. In fact, you're going to do greater works because I go to the Father. Christian, when the culture seems so bad, God is not saying, oh, pack it in. He's saying, no, you are going to do my works in this culture. You're going to do greater works in this culture. Some of you are saying, now you're getting Baptist-costal is what you're getting. But let's first of all look at the promise to the disciples. Let's look at the promise to the disciples. Turn with me to John 17, verse 9. John 17 and verse 9. I'm going to read 9, 10, and 11. Jesus is praying this lengthy prayer, and he first of all prays for his disciples. Verse 9, I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. And all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to you. Holy Father, keep through your name those whom you have given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, except the son of perdition, that the scripture may be fulfilled. What Christ is saying here is, look, he prays for the disciples that they would go and do his works. Did the disciples do his works? Yes, they did. They did works, a multitude of works. In fact, he goes on, and look, I am going to work through you, and these works that you're going to do are even going to be greater than mine. What does he mean by they're going to be greater than his? Remember the phrase, because I go to the Father. If Jesus would still be here, do you think we could better outdo Jesus? No. The only reason is because he was here for 3.5 years, and there's been 2,100 years since then, pretty much. We've had a lot longer time to share the gospel, to share with people. In fact, Peter stands up at Pentecost. He preaches, and how many people come to know Christ as their Savior? 3,000 people are saved and enter into the church all in one day. Man, can you imagine baptizing everybody? My arm would fall off by then. What an amazing thing that took place. Did Jesus ever see 3,000 people come to know him as their Lord and Savior at one time? Never recorded. But Christ, as he left, said, hey, look, the work is not done. Just because I am out does not mean that it stops. In fact, it's only going to increase. Kings and empires will rise and fall, but Jesus Christ and the gospel will continue. Don't worry about the church in Ukraine. It will remain. Don't worry about the church in Russia. It will not be destroyed. Don't worry about the gospel being stifled. You can't stifle the gospel of Jesus Christ. China's been trying to remove it. Can they? No. The more they try to stifle it, the more it gets out. Folks, we have great hope. And we are seeing the work of God continue, even though the world around us wants to try and stifle it. Even though it was wanting to come over it, there is work to be done, and we are on the winning team, amen? Oh, sheesh. That's why I'm trying to tell myself, stop grumbling, stop complaining, stop being like everybody else. I want you to leave today knowing that there is work to be done, and God wants to use us. How do I know that? Look at John 17. And I want you to look down here at verse 20 and 21. Again, Jesus' prayer does not stop with the disciples. Yes, Peter and John did miracles, and Paul did miracles, and I don't know that we need to do miracles here. I really don't see it as necessary. We have the Word of God in complete. Now, can God use miracles? Can God do miracles? Absolutely, He can if He so chooses. But He says this, verse 20, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. Through whose words? The apostles, the disciples' words. In other words, Jesus is saying, hey, the disciples, they're going to go and preach the gospel, and their spreading of the gospel is going to reach generations to come, and we're going to read from the apostles' words, and people are going to come to know Christ even in 2021, 2022, 2023, 2024, until the Lord returns. His gospel will be read and heard and responded to. But those who have responded to the word, verse 21, that they may all be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. Through you, me, you, individually, God wants to do His work through us. Where do you go to work at? God wants to use you there. God wants you to spread the news of Jesus Christ and His hope to a world that is just ever so confused. Don't think for a moment. You may say, but this is all I do. Pastor, you're a pastor and you have this huge platform. My goodness, you have a platform. You have people that you can touch their life with the Word of God. You can touch them by encouraging them and counseling them from the Word of God on a daily basis. Don't grow weary. God is not done with you. God wants to do a work through us. And I want to be careful here that we aren't getting too Pentecostal. Let me say this, and I hope I'm clear. I kind of touched on it already. You know, if God wants to do a miracle through you, number one, He's not going to say from 7 to 9 there will be a healing service. I never knew God or Jesus to say, healing services, 7 o'clock tonight, come. It was moved by the Holy Spirit. Yes, folks, that's just ice. That is a wonderful sound, actually. Hope your car is not parked right off the eve of the church. I have heard where God has done some amazing work. He's done what we would say are miracles. But the reason was so that the Word of God could be promoted, not the person. First Corinthians 14:5 says, I wish you all spoke with tongues or another language, but even more that you prophesied or proclaimed God's word. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets that the church may receive edification. Folks, the miracles that some people proclaim that they can do, the focus is on them, not the edification of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us be very clear. But if God wants me to speak in another language because somebody else needs to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and He's saying, look, right now, right here, here's the place, then I am sure my God could do that. And I would be done speaking in whatever language it was and think, what in the world just happened? It wasn't planned, it wasn't timed, it wasn't intentional on my part. But I will tell you this, I've never had that happen. I doubt that it will, but if it does, I'll let you know. But God can use us in any way that He wants. I want you to bring back to John chapter 14. The source of the power. A walk of faith, praise in Jesus' name. Verses 13 and 14. Whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. These verses have been so twisted and turned for selfish reasons. We want to pray in Jesus' name, thinking that it's a magic formula. If I pray in Jesus' name, then that's the magic formula, that if I do that, then God will give me whatever I want. It's not a magic formula. In fact, listen to Christ's own word. Turn with me to John 16, just a couple chapters over for clarification. John 16, verse 24. Jesus is teaching his disciples more. In that day you will ask me nothing. Most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. Asking the Father in my name. Verse 26 and 27. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I shall pray the Father for you. In other words, we're not praying to Jesus and then he's going to pray to the Father. For the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from God. So when I pray, whether it's in Jesus' name, God the Father's name, it doesn't matter. Dear God, I am praying to whom? We have direct access to God. Isn't that a marvelous thing? When I pray in Jesus' name, I'm praying on his merit, not my own. It's what he has done in his ability, not my own. I'm saying, dear God, if it's in your will, if it's something that would bring glory to God, which brings us to our second point about prayer and faith, prayer aimed for God's glory. Why do we pray? How do we pray? He's teaching the disciples that you need to be in prayer, but what kind of prayer is it? We're going to look to John again, but we're going to go to his letter, 1 John. We're going to look at 1 John 3 and verse 22. Right before Revelation, there's Jude, and then you get into 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, right? At the end of your Bible. 1 John 3, 22. So much prayer is aimed or misses the mark. 1 John 3:22, whatever we ask, we receive from him because we keep his commandments and do those things that are what? Pleasing in his sight. How often are we asking God to do something and we ourselves are not living for him? We have no intention of living for him. He's telling his disciples, you know what? You pray in my name, but you also need to be living in a way that glorifies me. How many times do people blame God for things, and yet in their own personal life, they are disobeying God's commands? And they're saying, why is this happening to me? And you as a Christian want to say, why are you living this way? Why are you rejecting and being disobedient in your life, and then you expect your Father to just say, oh, okay, I'll answer that? For I think that we have to be serious, and Jesus was, he was concerned about his disciples, that they were praying in his name. They were praying to glorify him. Turn with me to 1 John 5, verse 14. 1 John 5 and verse 14. Not only do we need to be living and desiring to keep his commandments, but also 1 John 5:14 and 15. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to what? His will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. Praying according to his will, which will bring glory to him. How often are our prayers very much all about what will bring us comfort, not him glory? And this is even I speak to myself, because I pray these prayers, dear God, please heal this person. Why? Is it for His glory, or is it for my comfort or that family's comfort, and that's it? That's hard to... Well, isn't that a good prayer? Well, I think we have to be careful. Is it God's will that Ukraine remains free? Is it the proper prayer to pray for this war to just stop? What if this is God's prophecy coming about? The beginning of it moving in this direction towards what we read in Daniel and Ezekiel and into Revelation. May we have our prayers guided by God's will and what will bring glory to Him. Do I know what's going to bring glory to God in this regard? I know the prayers that I should pray. Dear God, may Your gospel spread as a result. That's a prayer that's in His will, is it not? Amen. Let us think about what will bring glory to Him, and that begins to change my prayers from these quick little prayers that we prayed as children to prayers that should be of mature believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Why do I want this person healed? Moses prayed for the children of Israel that God would not strike them all dead because of His name to be glorified. Dear God, what would happen if You strike us all dead? And all the nations said, well, what kind of God strikes everybody dead? Lord, it was all about His glory, not Moses' glory. It wasn't even about the people's comfort or glory. It was about, God, Your name be lifted up. May we be careful how we pray. To walk by faith and not by sight. We need to recall God's words, His works, and we also need to realize God is not done with us. God wants to use us as a church, as individual believers. He wants us to use us in the culture today. He wants to show His glory. He wants to show His power. And we've got to be willing to say, dear God, use me. Use me in conversations. Use me in my day-to-day life. Use me how You want to use me. And may I surrender myself to You. Surrendering ourselves to what He wants, not what we want. Surrendering ourselves for His glory, not our glory. I talked to BJ this the other day, and I wanted to be clear that as we talk about walking by faith and not by sight, just a few years before they got to Bangladesh and working at the hospital that they worked, he shared the story of how the angst, the hatred there was for the Muslims to the Christians. And they didn't like the hospital, not because of what they were doing physically, but because they got word and understood that they were forcing people to become Christians, taking them out of the Islamic faith. And so 7 miles away in another village, there became a gathering, a mob. And they began to gather not just a handful of people, but 1,000 Muslim men, picked up everything, whatever they needed, and they began to march towards the hospital 7 miles away. And their intent was to burn it down and to kill the Christians. That was what they were going to do. It was during the dry season. No storms, no rain, nothing like that. And so could you imagine, number one, walking 7 miles. But for them, their anger was so enraged that it didn't matter. They got word back at the hospital that 1,000 of them were coming. And what did they do? They began to pray, dear God, help us. We don't have a way to defend ourselves. While they were making their trek to the hospital, a storm came out of nowhere. The storm caused water to hit the roads, and those roads had dry oil on them. You know what happens when oil and water begin to mix? Yeah, it gets really slick. A bus was coming by, this mob hit the slick and wiped out 50 Muslims in that moment, injuring them. Guess where they took them? Instead of trying to destroy the Christians, two men came to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior as a result. God protected that compound, that ministry. And that which they were going to destroy, they began to be thankful for because it saved the lives of their friends. You see, these are the greater works and the works that we can see God do when we pray. When we become dependent upon God more than our own resources and our own abilities. And I'll tell you what, it's hard in America, really to some extent, to pray because we have a lot of resources available to us, don't we? Few of us have been, well, I'd say all of us at one time or another, we've been at the end of some of the resources that we had, and we wondered, how was this going to happen? Some of you have been in situations where you thought, Lord, I don't know what to do or what is going to happen next. And you saw God come through. And the only prayer that you prayed was, dear God, help. Dear God, help. Dear God, help. Some of you have told me you haven't even known the words to pray because all you knew was, dear God, I need your help. I don't even know what your will is. I just need your help. And God did his work through your faith walk rather than what you can see. I would encourage you. This is just another thing that we need to do to maintain God's light in today's culture, is to walk by faith and not by sight. Watch and see the work that God will do through those who faithfully follow him, even when it seems like it's the end. And maybe it's actually just the beginning of you seeing what God is going to do. Let's pray. Father God, we come. Oh Lord, we come before you. And Lord, I'm so thankful that the disciples were encouraged because you had work for them that was going to take place, and they were going to be in absolute amazement of what you were going to do. May we who are sitting here today, nearly 2,100 years later, be encouraged that you prayed for us. Clear back in John 17. And Lord, you have a work that you want to do through us. And greater works than possibly than what you were able to accomplish because you went back to the Father. Lord, we do not know what those works are, but just use us. If it's just with one person, a group of people, or a multitude of people. Lord, whether it's through life or through death, may we surrender ourselves to your will to be done. That we would just be focused on one thing, trusting you. Trusting you when that does not seem to be the most reasonable responses. Lord, may our human reasoning submit itself to the faith that you've called us to walk in. Father, I thank you for not leaving us without a word. For not just leaving us and saying, good luck, you're on your own. Lord, you have a mission for us to do in this time and in this culture. Lord, may we just again surrender ourselves to you to do your work. And may we marvel at what you have done through simple trusting you. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Are you struggling to trust God with something in your life? You're trying to do it in your own understanding. Instead of using his words, you're using your words. Instead of using, in a sense, letting him do his work, you're trying to do the work. And does your prayers reflect that? The good news is that's why you're here today, is to submit ourselves to that very thing. Father, again, we just thank you for the opportunity to be reminded by your word. And Lord, help us to live by faith, not by sight. We pray this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Let's all stand together. And as we do, and praise and worship team comes, my faith looks up to thee. What a great way to end. My faith looks where? Up to thee, not to me. And may our faith be looking at Jesus Christ and him alone for the direction that we need on a daily basis.
Cindy would like to meet with you Sunday, March 13th, in the library. That is that room with the open door right over there. After church, we'll hand out the scripts and tell you about the practice times. So put that on your list. Secondly, we need some help in back right after this. Tomorrow is our blood drive in the MPR. And so if we could have some people go back and help to set up chairs and tables, we would appreciate that. And then finally this, we've had a number of instances where we've had some people who are not handicapped parking in the handicapped area because it is closer to the door. We would ask you, please, if you are not handicapped, do not park in those spots. Because if someone comes who is handicapped, you're putting them out. And we want to make sure that they have the easiest access possible. So please do not do that. With that, let's go forward this week and be salt and light to a world that desperately needs it. Let's close our time in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we do have your word. We thank you that we do know what you have to say, that you have revealed yourself through your word. And God, we ask that you would help us as we navigate dark waters, dark times, confusing times. And Lord, that we may choose to live by faith and not walk by sight. That we may do that more this week. That we may rely on you and have your strength made perfect in our weakness. And that people would see that. And that they would say, what's different about you? What do you have that I don't? Why do you have peace in your situation? Why do you have joy? And that we may be able to tell them about our dear Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and what he has done for us. And we thank you for that and the opportunity to do so. Help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. It's a bright shirt.